Now that you've got your application running in Kubernetes in the cloud, it's time to look at how we're going to maintain this application and deploy new code to it. So that's what we're going to do today. In this tutorial, we're going to do two main things. We're going to take a look at what it takes to deploy application updates into a Kubernetes cluster, and then we're going to dance around the issue that is running database migrations when you're deploying nothing but images. So going back to where we ended the previous tutorial, we have our application running inside of a Kubernetes cluster. This is my public IP for this particular one. And now we want to deploy some updates to this. So that means we're going to have to do a few things. And the cool thing about this is, even though we're using a Ruby on Rails application right now, the steps are pretty much the same for most web applications, I'm going to say. And that is, we have to create a new image that has our code in it. We have to upload the image to a repository that Kubernetes can access. We have to update our deployment to reference this new image. And then we have to tell Kubernetes to update the deployment. So for us to get started, first thing we have to do is make a meaningful change to our application that we can see once we've got it deployed. So one thing I am starting in this tutorial is I want to give you a good starting point if you're following along. So I've actually started to tag the repo, and I have whatever I'm calling the tutorial right here, and then before, and this will give you the exact starting point that I'm using for this. So if you copy down the meal plan repository from github.com/coderjourney/meal plan, then you can grab these tags. And to use this tag, you would do git checkout, you can give it the tag name. This will put you in a detached state, and then you just make a branch from here. So we'll git checkout B, and then we'll call this Kubernetes application updates. So what we're actually going to do today is we're going to create a new model, because creating a new model requires a new database migration. And then we're going to create some fake data for that model and then display that in the view. That way we can see that our deployment happened without us having to do anything. So to get started, I actually do want to make some changes. So we're going to make a change to config application.rb. And we're going to go down and mess with these generators. I know this is not a Rails specific thing, but I'm just going to get rid of these. So we want to get rid of helper. We want to get rid of JavaScript. And we want to get rid of style sheet. Okay, so we'll save that and quit. There is another change that I want to make, and I feel really bad about this one because it's a long-standing typo that's existed in this application the entire time that it's been around. And that is, if we go into docker-compose.yaml on line 12, this should be data, not db data. So I feel really bad if anybody copy and pastes this and then tries to use it in production, and then they eventually go to upgrade their db image because they will legitimately lose their volume, or they won't know how to access it, I guess is the way I would put it. So let's save that, quit. From here, locally, we're going to do a docker compose, and then we're gonna rmv db, and we'll just start over with this. So docker compose. Upd. And now what we want to do is we want to actually run something in our container. So we want to run the generator for this. So we're going to do docker compose run dash dash rm app rails g model, and then it's going to be ingredient. And then we want this to have a name that's going to be a string. Okay, now we're going to actually grab this database migration file, and we're going to modify this to work a little bit different. So we're going to have this be up. We're going to define it down that drops the table. And then in here, we're just going to create a few. So we'll give it a name. This will be olives, lettuce, and time. All right, and what we're doing here is we're creating a table that has one field, and then we are creating a couple database objects for this. And because of that, there's no good way for Rails to automatically reverse this. So instead of having a change so it would know how to do the up and the down, we have to manually define up and then manually define down. So we'll save that now. To make sure this works, we should probably run it. So we'll do docker compose run dash dash rm rake, db, we're actually going to have to create it, and then db migrate. Oops. Got to put the app container in there. Okay, everything's good to go. Now, the last thing we really need to do here is we want to be able to see that our deployment was made. So we're going to just make a slight modification to a view. So we'll do app views, welcome show, and in here we'll reference the ingredients and just print out the count. So we'll create a new one here that we'll say existing recipes. This will be recipe.count. Then we'll copy that and then call this unique ingredients. Ingredient.count. Okay, so we save that, quit. Now, just looking at the database migration, when we're deploying an image, by default, in Rails' case, we're going to need the database to be in the right state before we can use the ingredient model, because it's an ORM and it has to map to a database table. So that means we have a couple different options when it comes to doing migrations. One, you ship your migrations first. So that means rather than us creating all of this stuff, creating the model and the migration at the same time, we would create a migration that has zero code changes elsewhere and deploy that, and then we would manually run the migration. And then in a separate change, we would deploy our code changes. So that's one way of doing it. Or in our case, what we could do is we could have it automatically run the migrations every time we deploy our production image when it starts the container. That's a little bit more dangerous, but it's a little bit easier for us in this case too. So this allows us for a very fluid, continuous deployment sort of thing, which maybe we'll get into later. But it also means that we have to be sure that our migrations are safe and that they're not going to fail, because there's no way for us to roll them back if we're automatically running migrations when we're starting up the container. So I think while the application is still small, doing the automatic deployments and migrations is fine. And then as the application gets bigger and bigger and bigger, then it's probably better to transition more into a manual flow of running the database migration separately from code changes. So for us right now, we're going to add this to script start. We're going to add rake db migrate. And this just means every time we try to start up our container in production, it's going to make sure that the database is fully migrated. Now we need to build our image. So before we do that, let's take a look at our deployment meal plan and see what the image is that we're using. So right here on line 16, the repository that I have in the Google container registry is usgcr.io, my meal plan project, and then my meal plan image. So we will actually, we'll iterate on this, right? So we're adding a feature and it's a non-breaking change, but it's not a bug fix. So that I would call this a minor update. Semver is a little weird if you're doing web applications. This is probably not how I would do it in the long term, but this seems like a reasonable name. So we'll copy this so that we can eventually make this our container name or image name. Sorry. So we made that change and we won't have to come back to it again, but what we're going to do is we're going to do Docker build and we'll call it CoderJourney meal plan 1.1.0. We'll give it the file of Dockerfile prod and then the context of right here. Now that the image built, we have to tag it. So we'll Docker tag, and this will be coder journey. We called it meal plan 1.1.0. And then we want to tag that with this new image name. And then now we need to push this up to our Google Cloud. So I'm already signed in with mine. If you're looking to learn more about the Google Cloud stuff, then watch the previous tutorial, which I'll put a link in the YouTube video. But we'll say Google Cloud Docker, and then we'll push this new image. Thankfully, unlike the first time we did this, this push will actually be pretty fast because the layers that are lower in the stack are already cached, so we don't have to push hundreds of megabytes worth of stuff. Looking at the deployments meal plan thing again, making sure we have it updated to what we need. We only made one change to this. So normally the way we've created things up to this point is we've used kubectl create F, and then we've given it something like this. But if we run this now, we're going to run into an error, and that's because the deployment already exists. We've already created meal plan before, which this does totally make sense, right? So what we're actually trying to do is we're trying to apply a change to a deployment that is in our cluster. Thankfully, kubectl apply does just that. So if we make a modification to the file, it'll only change that aspect of it. It basically, one way to kind of think about it is sort of diffs the configuration that exists on the server and the configuration you're trying to give to it. And any changes that you have made, it will then apply those exact changes. But if there are lines that you like left out of an application file, then it wouldn't care. It would just keep what was already there. So we'll do kubectl apply dash f, that same thing. And I've already run an apply on this before. I just reverted everything when I was doing my dry run for this particular tutorial. But you'll actually see a warning. And that warning will say something about kubectl apply should be used on resources created by either kubectl create dash dash save config or by creating them using kubectl apply. And the reason we didn't talk about apply before is because when you're first starting with Kubernetes, applying a file doesn't really make sense. But creating a resource based on a file does totally make sense. That being said, now that you know about apply, this should be what you're using almost every time. Create's really not worth it. If you have a resource that you're creating that doesn't exist in Kubernetes and you do kubectl apply dash f like this right here, it will do the same thing as what create would have done originally. The only difference is that it's easier to make changes later on. So let's take a look at our pods, make sure everything is running. And if we go back over and we reload our page, you can see that our database migration did indeed run and it created our three values. And now we have an updated Rails application in our Kubernetes cluster. I hope that you enjoyed this tutorial. If you did, be sure to leave a comment down below telling me why you liked it and what you're going to do with this knowledge. Be sure to subscribe to the channel so you can get more of these tutorials each week. And also don't forget to join us on Patreon, Facebook, Slack, so you can keep the chat going, and on Twitter. But as always, have a nice week.